लेक्सिकल एनालाइजर, सिंटेक्स एनालाइजर एंड सिमेंटिक एनालाइजर. सो दिस थ्री काइंड ऑफ एनालिसिस हैपेंस यू नो एंड ऑल थ्री आर एनालिसिस एंड दे चेक्स द लेक्सिकल एनालाइजर चेक्स यू नो द टोकन वाइज करेक्टनेस. सो इट चेक्स द टोकन्स. Okay, then syntax analyzer is there. It analyzes the grammar. Okay, and you have the semantic analyzer, which analyzes the logical things. Logical, you know, validity of your code, like whether you are dividing it by zero, like some, you know, unsupported operation you are going to do, or doing something array out of bound operation, or you are doing some type casting, or you know explicit casting or conversion, which is supported or not supported. All these things are analyzed in this phase called semantic analysis phase. Okay, the remaining phases of the compiler are called synthesis phases. So why these phases are called synthesis phases? Reason is that in these phases you can see, first you have intermediate code generator. So it does generate some kind of intermediate code here. Okay, it can be, you know, three address code. Three address code, you know, you will find, we will discuss later in detail. This is quite similar to assembly language code, but not exactly assembly language code. Instead, we split the complex instruction in your source code into small instructions, or, you know, one operator per instruction. Okay, so in this way, we you know, divide, or you can say we not optimization, we convert our code to a new form, which is called three address code. Okay, then comes, so it is a synthesis happens here. Why? Yes, it is generating something. Okay, then optimization. Again, optimization will do three address code. You will find that there is, you know, many unnecessary variable has been generated. Many, you know, instructions, small instructions has been generated, which can be optimized. Okay, keeping this concept of three address code intact. Okay, so this is the reason. This is another synthesis happens here. Then the target code generation happens here. Okay, so the optimized whatever intermediate representation you have, that is converted to target code. Now, if your target code is assembly code, then you will find that the output is coming, you know, as a assembly code. So this is another kind of generation happens here. So we can call it as a synthesis. And then the target code said here you have assembly code. So that is going to be optimized again. Okay, so it generate another optimized code. Okay, so in this way, you know, this last four phases, these four phases works. So we call them as synthesis phase. Okay, next is another way we can divide, or we can classify these phases. You can see these phases are written as machine independent phases, or we also called as front end of the compiler. So why? Because, you know, these phases does not matter, you know, does not consider on what machine you are working. You have what kind of processor you have, and how many bit of processor you have, whether you have a 8-bit processor or 16-bit processor or 32-bit processor, whatever you have. This page does not consider them. Whether your processor architecture is a RISC architecture or CISC architecture, it does not consider them. Okay, so the output of this optimized, here at this point, what output you get, that is optimized intermediate code, that can be transferred to any other machine, and again you can do the remaining operation. Okay, so these parts are called as machine independent phases, or front end of the compiler. Okay, and in the same way, after this phase, these two phases are called machine dependent phase, because when their their compiler is going to generate the target code, so it need to know on which machine or your target machine where you are going to execute your code. So this target machine can have different kind of processor, right? So how many bit of processor, either it is 8-bit, whether it is 16-bit, or so on, what processor is there, whether the architecture is, I think, RISC architecture or CISC architecture is there, on the machine's processor. So accordingly it will generate the target code. Okay, then, because that if you consider assembly language, so assembly language codes can be little different when you are writing the code for 8-bit processor and when you are writing the code for 16-bit processor or 32-bit processor. Okay, because their size of number of register, size of register, accumulator, size of accumulator, all matters. If you have a 8-bit processor, that means your accumulator size is also, ACC we write in short, your accumulator size is also 8-bit. If you have a 32-bit processor, that means your accumulator size is 32-bit. So based on your machine, this target code will be generated. And as this target code is going to be optimized, definitely it is also going to be machine dependent. So these two phases are called machine dependent or back end of the compiler. Another reason is that in these two phases, the human intervention is almost zero. Okay, so that is the reason it is called back end on the compiler. Okay, now if you look at this, so we have all the phases of compiler here. How does your compiler works, or what which phase gives what output, and what output they gives, and how do we call them? So that we should know. So the first phase, we know the lexical analyzer, which is having which gets the input. Input here is the source code. Okay, now you all know what lexical analyzer does. It checks each character in your code or each symbol in your code, whether the symbols are valid symbol or not. Okay, then it checks the each word or each string. Okay, and if there is every string in the code or every symbol in the code are valid according to your language specification, then it generates list of tokens. We also call them lexems. Okay, now these tokens comes as a input to syntax analyzer. Okay, this syntax analyzer takes these tokens and use the grammars and try to generate a tree. The tree is called as parse tree, and this phase syntax analyzer is also called as parser. Okay, so here we will have parser in this syntax analysis phase, and this parser will take these tokens and use the grammar stored into the parser, and using that it will generate a parse tree. And if this parser is successfully generate a parse tree, it will say there is no error. Okay, but if it says that if it is find that it is not possible to generate a parse tree using the token and what instruction you have provided to syntax analyzer, then it will say or it will give you error. Okay, so this parse tree goes as a input to the syntax analyzer, and this syntax analyzer then generates syntax tree. Okay, sorry, semantic analyzer, and that is the semantic analyzer generates syntax tree. Okay, then using this tree, your intermediate code generator generates some intermediate code. I have already told that what kind of intermediate code it can be. It can be a very common example is three address code. It can be three address code or any other code can be generated here. Okay, now this code goes to the optimization part and optimization of the intermediate code, which just optimize this intermediate code, and that is the output here. Then the target code generator generates the target code, and finally the optimized code is also, we can say this is our target code, which is the final outcome or output of the compiler. Okay, next, if you see in detail, say we have input expression position equal to initial plus rate into 60, then these things goes to this goes to lexical analyzer. Okay, so this lexical analyzer checks each of them and it store them in a symbol table. Okay, so that is what I had missed in the previous diagram I had to. Okay, so it will have a syntax table, sorry symbol table. Okay, so what happens in the symbol table? The symbol table is nothing but it is kind of a simple table. When the lexical analyzer gets one token, okay, say position, it insert this in a database, and database is called symbol table. Okay, so it gives the ID to it and the entry number that at which row it is entered. Okay, so this first row, second row, third row, fourth row. Okay, and it if it is say position, okay, position is a string, okay, or you can say variable name. So variable names we call as identifier. So here this ID, you can see here we have written ID. This is nothing but a variable name, then type. So what is the type of position? Position is nothing but identifier. Okay, so here it will identifier is represented by ID. So in the table, it will, the variable name will be position, type will be ID. Okay, so in short, now we can write ID comma one. That means in row number one, What is there? There is an identifier. So we don't need to write the position again. So this, this thing, ID comma one is called as token. Okay? And this name position is called as lexeme. Okay. So this is the difference between token and lexeme. You can understand, I think so. And this is how the lexical analyzer creates or generates token for each of the identifier. Okay. Now I have shown for sorry each of the identifier or variable names. But if you see the equal sign is here, the plus sign is here, and multiplication sign is here, and also we have 60 here. Okay, so you can see if these operators are carried out here as it is, and they have not entered because in the symbol table basically there is two part. One part is fixed, like for this equal sign, plus, multiplication. These are already there in a fixed part of the symbol table, so the lexical analyzer does not need to re-enter them. Okay, so detail of these things. Okay, so by default it can be treated as token. Okay, and the last one, if you see, multiplication ID 4 is written, and here it is 60. So here you sometimes you can treat the 60 as number also. Okay, so in many places you will find in the tree it is written number. Okay, but when it is going to be entered into a symbol table, it can be entered as an ID, no issue. Okay, so this is how the lexical analyzer works. So lexical analyzer basically generates all the tokens and keeps them in the symbol table. Okay, now these tokens and all these things and the symbol table are also accessible by the syntax analyzer. Okay, now you assume that your syntax analyzer is having a set of grammar rules, looks like this. Okay, and it got this. This thing from the lexical analyzer. So what your syntax analyzer will try to do? Syntax analyzer will try to construct a syntax tree or parse tree using this grammar rule to generate this string. Okay, this whole thing I am calling as string here. Okay, if it gets success to generate it, then it will say, okay, there was no error in the syntax. But it is by if your syntax analyzer finds that it is not possible, then it will say that there is error. But if it is succeed, then it will say there is no error, and it will send the output or whatever output generated by the syntax analyzer to the next page, which is semantic analyzer. Okay, now the syntax tree, if you see, we had a grammar rule. If you see here, we had a grammar rule is to E. Okay, that means S is nothing but starting symbol. Okay, then we have, if you see in the previous slide, there is another rule that is E to E plus t. So this rule is used here to generate e to e plus t. Okay, then there was another rule, t to t multiplication f. So t is expanded using this rule here, t multiplication f. Okay, then there was another rule that is, sorry, that is E to T. So using this rule, this A is converted to T, or you know, derivative to T. Okay. Then we had another rule, T to F, which is applied here and here. Okay. And then we have another rule, F to ID. Okay. So F is converted to ID here, F is converted to ID here, there we had F here, it is converted to ID here. Okay, so if you see here, this ID 1, sorry, here ID 2 I have written. Okay, however, this ID 2 is corresponds to position. Just a minute, sorry. This ID 2 is corresponds to initial. Okay, so this is nothing but initial. ID3, if you see, ID3 is corresponds to rate. And ID4 was corresponding to 60. Correct? So this tree, if I have, and if I have the symbol table, from the symbol table I can interpret what does ID2 means, what does ID3 means, and what does ID4 means. Then I can rewrite it like this. This tree is generating initial plus rate multiplication 60. So this is a buffer syntax, right? So if this is buffer syntax, the other part is not written, that is I think position equal to, right, that it is not required actually, because it is simply assignment of this whatever the outcome of this expression, or simply assigning here. Okay, so this is how your syntax analyzer will work. Okay. Now your question will be that what is the algorithm of generating this tree? This tree, when we are generating, based on our intuition that okay, E is there, so we can apply this rule. So we will get a plus in the middle, and the other two side will expand, and maybe will finally lead to this. Okay, so when your computer will do, that means your compiler is a software, right? It is going to execute. So at that time, how your compiler will decide that among these many rules, which rule to apply where? Understand? So for that, it will have a algorithm for developing the or for generating this tree, and that algorithm is called as parser. Understand? So different kind of parser we'll discuss later. Okay. Next, this tree was generated by your syntax analyzer, right? The syntax analyzer generated this tree. This tree goes as input to semantic analyzer. And the semantic analyzer try to generate another tree. This tree also sometimes called as syntax tree, the same with the same name. Okay, so it will try to generate this tree. Now here, see, the semantic analyzer is checking everything, whether the ID1 is there or not. So again, the semantic analyzer have access to the symbol table. Okay, so from the symbol table it checks that ID1 equal to ID1 is available there, what is this ID2, ID3, and it finds that here at this point it is ID4, and whose value in the symbol table is 60. So what it does, it can convert this to from into real. Okay, and then it puts 60 here instead of keeping here ID4. because there is no need of writing IT4 anymore here, because we have a constant value for IT4. So replace this IT4 with 60. Okay, so this things, these are logical things, okay, are done by the semantic analyzer, and it also checks that whether these operations are possible or not. Okay, if it is possible, then it will say that it will say it is okay, it will generate some output. And if it is finds that this tree is not possible to generate, if there is some illogical operator which is not supported, then it will give some error. Understand? So this is how the semantic analyzer will work, and this is how the output will look like. Okay. Next, intermediate code generator. So what we had in our expression, if you say, I can write it like this, ID1 equal to ID2 plus ID3 multiplication ID4. Okay, yes, most of the time we use comma also here. Okay, as they are tuples. Okay, now we know one thing, that ID4 is a constant, that is 60. Okay, so, and our semantic analyzer, for the sake of reducing the chance of error at the time of execution, this 60 was converted from int to float, or you can say real. Why? This ID3 is having interest rates. Now say sometimes the interest rate is coming 7.5%. Okay. Now your compiler, when you will, sorry, your processor, when you will execute your code, will multiply a real number with an integer if you don't convert this 60 to real. Okay, so it can give a type mismatch error. So to reduce that, what your semantic analyzer does, it converts this 60 to real. Okay, so this is called what? Implicit conversion. We don't understand that when we write C code or some other programming language, and all these things happens in the background, by the compiler, we don't realize it, but implicitly it happens. Okay, so this is a kind of complex expression for processor, because you can see here there is three different operators in a single instruction. So how we can simplify them, okay, to make something like one instruction, sorry, one operator or one operation per instruction. So if we try to do that, first operation we have to do is converting 60 to real. So we generate a temporary variable called temp1 equal to int to real 60. Okay, so now the our 60 going to store into temp1. Next, 60 was multiplied because multiplication is having a highest priority when you are going to do solve the arithmetic expression or evaluate the arithmetic expression. So we have to do this operation first. So it does take another temporary variable, temp2. Temp2 equal to ID3 into this, right? So this value is basically now became temp1. So multiplication with this become temp1. So temp1. Okay. Now sorry. Now the whole thing become evaluated, and that we have put it in attempt two, right? So next operation is a addition operation with the evaluated value of this part, this this part or attempt two part, which will be added to ID two. Okay, so again we take another temporary variable called temp three. Temp three equal to we do ID two plus temp two. Okay, so we get the result of this part. Okay, and this result is kept here into temp three. Now finally, what we can do? We can assign this temp three to ID zero one, sorry ID one, that is happened here. So you can see this complex, this whole complex expression is splitted into four small expressions, and you can see that these expressions are very easy to evaluate for a computer system. Okay, or if you want to even convert this expression to assembly language, it is quite simple to convert, right? So this is what the intermediate code generator does. Now next thing is that, so this is the output of intermediate code generator. This is the output. So this output is going to be sent to the intermediate code optimizer. So see what happening is in the optimizer. It got this output. Optimizer is doing see what. Instead of doing this line, it is simply adding, replacing this line by temp one by 60.0. So 60.0, you write, so it is a real number. So you don't need to explicitly type convert of a constant value, because it is constant value. Simply add 0.0, it becomes a floating point number. Okay, so one instruction reduced, removed, and only 0.0 is added with 60. So thing is solved. So this stamp is now become 60.0. So this is what happened here. Okay, then we have still temp two here, but as the, here in the new code we take temp one again. So you can write temp one dash. Okay, so you should not confuse with this temp one dash and temp one here. Okay, so this temp one dash is equal to ID three and 60.0. Okay, so you can say these two instruction, two is merged in one. Okay, then it is finding out that we have taken another temporary variable temp three, which is just storing this result, and in the next instruction in ID one we are assigning this value of temp three to ID one. So, but we can do simply merge these two instruction into ID one equal to ID two, and right now it is temp one. Okay, so plus temp one. Okay, so you can understand that we had four lines of code generated by the intermediate code generator, which are reduced to two lines by the optimizer. Okay, so I think it is clear for all how the optimizer, intermediate code optimizer, works. Okay, so what will happen, this optimization, why do we do? Reason is that when your code is going to execute, your processor will take or will utilize less amount of memory. First thing, less amount of memory to store this temporary variable. So only one temporary variable is here in the optimized code. But in the unoptimized code, you can see that there is 1, 2, and 3 temporary variable they are generating. Here it is only one. Okay, so there is space optimization in this way, There is definitely a number of operation are happening that is also optimized. Understand? So when this say unoptimized code is going to execute on the processor, it will take more time than this optimized code. Okay? So you have to understand, this is the reason I was telling you that if you have the concept of compiler design, then you are going to be a better coder. Why? Because who does not know all these things? This can be, this not can be, this should be converted to this. At the writing of the code, the source code itself, you can do this kind of optimization. You will find that many people are among your friends, they like to take numbers of variable, whenever they need. There are many people who write code in such a very few variables and code is done in few lines. So basically it matters. Both the code will do same task, but their execution time will be different and the memory used by those codes will be also different. Okay. So when you are going to write code for, say IoT devices, very small amount of memory is there. Say 32 KB of RAM is available. Okay. So in the at that time you have to keep optimization in your mind from the beginning itself, from when you are writing the source code itself. Okay. Now, if you have this optimized code, you can go for target code generator. So this target code, you can see it is quite similar, or it is a this target code is assembly language code. So how it is happening? It is first finding that you have a variable ID3 in the memory. Okay, ID3 will have some value, right? It is a variable. From the symbol table, it will check. It will check what is this ID3. Okay, it will find that it is a variable or identifier, and some value will be assigned to ID3. So what it will do? MOVF, then move the value of ID3 to register 2. You all understand this? Then it will see that this ID3 is multiplied with 60.0. So MUL, that is multiplication function, okay, in MULF, it will multiply 60 with register 2. Okay, so the result, it will be something like this. The result will again assign to register 2. So R2 equal to R2 into 60.0, sorry, 60.0 will happen here. Okay, then it will find another variable identifier, right? So it will just move the value from the memory, okay, from the primary memory or keyboard, from wherever the value is coming, the value of ID2 to again register 2. Sorry, it will be register 1 actually, okay. To register 1. Then it is finding that the previous result temp 1, the result of temp 1 is equivalent to register 2, is basically added to identify, this ID2. So ID2 is now register 1. So it can simply write, this instruction is simply do R1 equal to R1 plus R2. Right. So this is the instruction add R2 R1. Okay. Then finally, the calculated value is need to be stored in the memory or display as ID1's value. So it stores or it moves the value in the register 1 to ID1. Okay. So this becomes our target code. Now let's see whether this target code is optimized. No. Okay. So basically here I don't think it is possible to optimize for this particular code, but you know, if you have very long code like this,